So I'm Mike Gourlay, and tonight I'm going to tell you about how augmented and certain aspects of virtual reality platforms work just enough so that you can build experiences that exploit the strengths and avoid some of the pitfalls of those systems. So if you leave here with nothing else, I want to convey 3 points, which are to incorporate the environment in your experiences, and invent new control schemes. So you're talking about UX. So we need new control schemes for AR and VR that should be totally novel to that system. And then finally, to share the outward perspective that our AR provides. I'll explain what I mean by that. There's a very subtle and nuanced explanation of that. But by the end of the talk, you should be clearer on what that concept means. And I want you to think about how that sort of inside out perspective changes everything. And it's a little bit more than just the first person perspective, although there's a lot of overlap there with what I mean for the first person perspective. So I'll revisit all these topics in depth, but first I want to tell you who I am and why you should bother listening to me. And then I'm going to explain some fundamental aspects of augmented reality, most of which I assume are going to be familiar, but I'm going to give you my spin on them. And I'm going to describe the paradigm that I use to understand or to kind of think about the difference between AR and VR and also how they are similar. So a bit about me. I used to make video games. I used to work for EA Sports. In particular, I was, just as I left, I was the architect of Madden, and I've worked on other games there. I also built some various technologies, the most sort of visually apparent of which is this thing called Lynx, which is the visual effects system that is used by all EA Sports games worldwide. So if you've played an EA Sports game in the past 10 years, you've seen at least a few pixels that were from my engine. And so all the stuff back there, you'll see like everything, like the confetti, the fireworks, the blood, the smoke, even the light, sort of this, the sort of like crepuscular rays, all those are particle effects. And the snow, of course. And I also, in my spare time, make fluid simulations for video games. I've written 21 articles on that over the past few years that Intel published. I wrote my last article. It should be coming out soon, and then I'm done with it. But that's my other kind of fun thing to do, is make fluid simulations. Who does that? So while at EA, I also taught at University of Central Florida at a program called FIA, the Florida Interactive Entertainment Academy, which was a graduate program that teaches programmers, artists, and engineers how to make video games and other simulations. And now I work for Microsoft on the HoloLens platform. And so what I'm going to do today is tell you about some of the technologies that me and my teams have developed, but with a specific, you know, angle of, so what does that mean for you, like as an experienced developer? And you can see in the pictures there, that's just me hanging out in Fremont, my home neighborhood. It's just what I look like when I'm in the future. So I'm going to tell you about augmented reality. I assume that you're already familiar with the term, or else you probably wouldn't have showed up. But that term has some nuances that I want to unpack. And I'll contrast that with virtual reality and kind of explain sort of my parsing of those two terms. But first I'm going to explain some really simple aspects of augmented reality. Again, I expect all these to be familiar, but I want to really drill down into certain aspects of them, because later I'm going to be talking about how they happen, and it'll just be better set up if you're kind of mentally prepared for them. So first of all, let's look at this video. You've got this little boy who is, you know, standing in some courtyard in Tokyo. And meanwhile, the person who is observing this is on some train. And this is, Kyoto, not Tokyo. So, this is an AR experience. And there's an illusion that's going on here that's very simple, yet very powerful. And to pull off this illusion requires very sophisticated sensors and very sophisticated algorithms and monumental amounts of computation. So, by the way, this video is from a colleague of mine who works on HoloLens. His name is George Klein, and this is from his research back when he was more of an academic. So let's look at what's going on here. One of the first key features of that video that I just showed was that Cartman seemed to be locked to the world, right? He wasn't just sort of composited in screen space. He seemed to be as though he were actually out there in the three-dimensional space of this. So that term world locked, I'm gonna use a lot. And that's what I mean by that, is basically he's stuck to the world, okay? The second aspect is that he is occluding the real world. So he's not just positioned in that three-dimensional space. He's also sort of interacting with it in the sense that he is apparently blocking light that comes from behind him. And the last aspect is that he seems to obey, like he's not doing a lot right now, but he's not violating our understanding of the physical world. For example, he's not falling through the ground, he's not interpenetrating objects. So these are the three aspects that are just the sort of basics of AR. If you didn't have those three things, you would break this illusion. And I'm gonna tell you how this works and reveal that like some of these things, even though they seem really simple, are actually incredibly sophisticated and they're very difficult to pull off. But before I get into how that works, I'm gonna talk about a few other aspects of augmented reality. So one of them is the display technologies. And I'm gonna make a contrast between an additive renderer and a composited renderer. So in this case right here, this is obviously pure fiction, right? I mean, this is just, you know, a clip, you know, a frame from a movie. But the fundamental concept is represented here very well, which is that this hologram is just light that is added to the scene, independent of how, you know, presumably this like particular display works, who cares? But the point is that like when you put on a HoloLens, it's doing the same kind of thing as this is, which is that it's only adding light to the scene. Now, one thing I'll mention is that when you see this in this movie or in Star Wars or in like Minority Report, and a lot of the Hollywood depictions show this really diaphanous, translucent rendering of stuff. Who here has actually tried a HoloLens? So more than half of you. My experience, and I think that you all agree, is that even though it is only additive and technically therefore only translucent, the holograms actually look a lot more solid than this, meaning they don't actually have this kind of see-through quality unless the scene behind them is extremely bright. Does anybody vehemently disagree with that claim? No one? Okay, so my point is that even though it's only adding light, the dynamic range of our eyeballs is such that it doesn't take that much light to sort of completely overwhelm the light that's coming through from behind. And so you can get this, you can get a really convincing sense that this is actually a solid object. The caveat to that though is that you have to render that with very bright colors. So you could not, for example, render a vivid black hologram. It's completely impossible with additive technology because you can't add black. Black is the absence of light. So that's a drawback of additive rendering. At least as it stands today, there's no such thing as an anti-photon. So that's, I guess you could say, one of the takeaways if you're gonna develop for augmented reality platforms is to make your scenes and your objects and your characters very bright, very saturated. So in contrast to this is another display technology that we're more familiar with, which is composite rendering. So here, this is also, you could say, augmented reality. But the difference is that here, black things are also opaque. What's going on here is that the display is simultaneously showing the real world and the virtual world by presumably having a camera that is a pass-through feed of video onto which a three-dimensional scene is rendered and then composited. So the benefit of this is you could get to render black. The drawback is if the power goes out, you're completely blind. And also there's a bit of lag with the video and so on. So in this, you know, situation, the camera's on a tripod, some of these problems don't show up right away, but you could imagine a world where somebody has a kind of composite rendering headset and, you know, makes a VR, an AR headset using this compositing technology. So aside from different rendering techniques, AR and VR require a completely different input model. So the user interface design is bound to be very different. Right now we live in exciting times because of that problem. That problem is an opportunity for us to make new paradigms for how our users interact with stuff. And So let me make a comparison to some 2D interfaces. So back in the 70s and the 80s, a lot of the two-dimensional graphical user interface paradigms and metaphors showed up. Like, for example, buttons and windows and scroll bars showed up pretty much right away. Like as soon as Xerox or whoever you want to say came up with the idea of a graphical user interface, a lot of those elements showed up right away. And a lot of those stuck. Not shown here, though, is a tab. Everybody knows what a tab is now, but what's interesting to me about tabs is even though they're basically in every kind of GUI there is right now, and they make intuitive sense to us because there's this direct metaphor to actually flipping through a file folder, tabs didn't show up for a couple of decades until after this kind of stuff. And I think that my point is that even the really, really basic stuff, I don't think anyone thinks we're done with 2D GUIs yet, but even the really basic stuff took literally decades to come up with. And so we're only in less than a year into what I would call widespread VR and AR. Like 2016 is sort of the year of the head-mounted display. Yes, there were things before it, but they weren't as widespread, they weren't as commercial, they weren't really aimed at consumers. But now they are, and I think that the problems that people will have in getting interested in AR and VR are all around control schemes and are all around usability, not necessarily around the display technology or other aspects of technology, but purely about design. So I'm going to show some examples of stuff that I think is a sign of the times, meaning like people are just throwing stuff at the wall and seeing what sticks. And a lot of the stuff will totally not stick, but it was really, really fun to be around when they tried. So here's an example. One of the problems in 3D user interfaces, especially in an immersive experience, is something that we generally use menus to solve. So menus make a lot of sense when there's this kind of desktop paradigm or metaphor where you're used to seeing something like a menu in a flat space where positioning it isn't really a big deal. But in an immersive space, there's always this weird problem of like, I want to pull up a menu. What would be the sort of physical justification for a menu to appear out of nowhere in front of me? There really isn't one. And so people struggle with that. And so here's a shot from Fantastic Contraption where they thought, well, you know what we'll do is we want you to build stuff, and so you should have a kind of menu of options, to like tools and building blocks, but we don't want you to pull up this menu, and so instead we'll have a cat that follows you around, because cats kind of just follow you around anyway, except that this cat is going to have a bunch of stuff on it that are the building blocks of, this experience. Now, Fantastic Contraption is fantastical, and so they can get away with a lot of crazy stuff. So this is not something that would generally apply. I don't expect this to be a concept that catches on in this particular form, but it's really fun to see. And by the way, the cat will also like play with you. So you can like pet the cat and it'll roll on its back and you can pet its tummy and all that kind of stuff. So I think that's awesome. So another one is Modbox, where they use a metaphor of a palette, and by which I mean like a real painter's palette. So you have a palette of options in one hand and something like a brush in the other, where you kind of stab the palette with the brush and that picks up a tool and then you can go and build stuff with that tool. And the cool thing about that is it's already familiar. Even if you've never painted anything, I've never painted anything with like a palette and a brush in my life. But if somebody stuck a palette in one hand and a brush in the other, I would immediately know what to do, especially if I was in front of something that I was supposed to be building. You just kind of like, it's super intuitive about how to select your tools. So that one's probably going to be a little bit stickier, I would imagine. This is one of my favorite ones. This is from Valve's The Lab. And the basic idea is this. You have a variety of virtual worlds that you want to be able to enter. And again, they're trying to solve the menu problem. So if you want to enter a virtual world in a way that feels like you're not sort of, that feels like it belongs. The way that they chose to do that was they have this sort of gallery of snow globes. And to enter that virtual world, you physically enter the snow globe, meaning you can either shove your head into the snow globe or you can pick up the snow globe and shove it on your head. So you are literally entering the world in the sense that like you're climbing inside of the snow globe, but the act of doing that also spawns that new world. And so there's this opportunity for this kind of seamless entering of this world. So I really like that one. There's another game called Job Simulator where, again, they wanted to have the kind of a seamless experience of exiting the job simulator. So something that wasn't as obvious as like, you know, a menu. I guess they could have just made a door that had an exit sign over it or something, but they didn't do that. They chose instead to have a burrito. I'll replay that. And so you grab the burrito and it says exit on it in sauce, and then you eat it. And then it says really, so to confirm that you really want to exit this, you finish eating the burrito. And so that's how you exit Job Simulator. So anyway, it's a really exciting time. I expect to see more stuff like that, meaning by which I mean crazy stuff that'll be really fun. And then we'll like 20 years from now, we'll think back, hey, remember the exit burrito? And the whatever comes after millennials will not get it. And then we'll have smug, you know. nostalgia. So here's a last one that I want to point out, which is, so here is, this kind of shows what I think is one of the big problems of AR or VR. So this is an AR app where you can sculpt something. And so you can kind of squirt clay out of this cursor, and the cursor is that sphere. And then that sphere also lets you, you know, change the color of the clay and whatnot. So I would say that this demonstrates the problem, which is that, like, you just saw this video. Probably most of you are thinking, yeah, it's an unremarkable video about somebody squirting clay, you know, like, it's cool that it's like AR, but I mean, at this point, like, it's already several months into the AR world. This is not that interesting looking, but imagine what was going on with this user. They were doing this in order to draw this, like, hat, you know, heart. They were literally, like, moving their head. Like, it's just a terrible experience. So don't do this. But I mean, I think that this is a good example of you know, the problem in front of us, which is, okay, we've built this cool technology, now how do you use it? So what is the controller story? What is the input story? And the real answer is nobody has figured that out yet. I could go on and on about this. There's one aside that I have was, I think that whoever's gonna win, you know, in this kind of sense of like what company is gonna have the, sell the most units and make the most money and all that sort of thing, will actually be around content. And because I think that right now there's plenty of VR and AR experiences out there, plenty meaning like hundreds, not millions, but there are lots. But very, very few of them are compelling. And I think one of the biggest reasons is just how do you walk around? Nobody has really answered that question yet. Okay, so I want to talk about another aspect of this sort of first-person perspective, which is about telepresence. I think one of the big promises of AR and VR is telepresence. I'm certainly looking forward to it, and I'm ready to hand my wallet over to anybody who can solve this problem for me. But I want to point out that there's actually another kind of telepresence that we haven't seen before, at least I hadn't seen before we actually went and started building stuff. And I'm going to call that shared outward perspective. So here's an example of telepresence that exists right now. Like if you have HoloLens, you can get it, you know, comes with Skype. And there's a version of Skype that runs on it, which communicates with desktop Skype in the way that is depicted here, which is, so this woman is wearing a HoloLens and she is looking at her sink and talking to her dad, who is wearing, or who's using a desktop Skype and who can see what she sees, okay? So he's trying to explain to her, presumably, I infer from this picture, how to replace the, you know, trap on this sink. And so he's trying to indicate, like, okay, this part goes here and all that kind of stuff. So he sees what she sees, and then he can draw on the tablet, but those augmentations stick in 3Space in her world. So she actually sees the things that he is drawing, and they are stuck in 3, you know, they're world locked in 3Space. So no matter what angle she sees that from, those augmentations are going to stick there. So that is a form of telepresence, but it isn't one that I had seen in like Star Wars or, you know, all the other places where I generally have seen telepresence before 2016. So here, you know, this upper left frame is the like a picture, you know, again, a still image from one of the Star Wars movies where you see this holographic dude sitting in a chair and he's presumably having this meeting with a bunch of other people. And that is something I also want, but bear in mind that a headset by itself, which has this outward-looking perspective, cannot create this scene. It can, if these two were wearing a HoloLens, they'd be able to see that, but the hol, there, you know, this guy would need something else capturing him. So that's what's depicted here, where there's an environment here with cameras that are both depth cameras and color cameras, and they're capturing a live feed of Shyam. Now, I don't know why in this case Shyam is talking to himself, but just suspend disbelief for a moment. The same kind of situation is set up for his daughter in some other place, you know, where there's a bunch of stuff capturing her and then he can see her. There's a local company called, I think I took a note. What is it?
Identity Mind.
Identity Mind, yeah, and they were acquired by a company called Valorum Consulting. So they're local and they make a thing called HoloBeam, which you can actually download, which does something like along these lines. So both of these forms of telepresence exist, but one of them, like this, oops, the one that I just showed you was the one that I think we were all expecting. The one that I wasn't expecting was this one, the shared outward perspective. And so I had mentioned at the beginning of this talk that I want you to think about that problem. By the way, the New York Times just a few days ago released an article talking specifically about that notion of a shared outward perspective. And how you induce empathy by showing somebody else what you see instead of showing them your face, right? We're all used to seeing each other's faces and inferring, you know, from facial expressions, you know, how are you feeling, et cetera, right? How am I feeling? You can tell by looking at me. But what can you infer by seeing what I'm seeing? This isn't something that we're used to thinking about. We've played first-person games and, you know, like, but there aren't any movies that really are, like, all about first-person perspective. There is a movie called Dark Passage with Humphrey Bogart where the first several minutes of the movie are all first-person perspective. And, you know, they try to tell this story of, like, what's going on with this guy? What kind of situation is he in? What is he feeling? And then there's also in Diamond Age, a kind of similar theme is explored, but there's going to be a lot more of that, so I challenge you all to figure out a way to kind of put that to use. So just to recap, some of the technologies that I talked about, additive rendering is in contrast to composite rendering, and the takeaway is make your holograms and your scenes and objects and characters brightly lit if you're going to be rendering for additive displays. And there's this notion of first-person control, which means that you'll have to figure out ways of dealing with that problem of, like, you don't have the option of taking the camera away from your own eyeball. That's never been true before. Even in first-person shooters, you could choose to detach the camera from your avatar, but in AR, that's never an option. And then if you want to convey or share an experience with someone, you have a different way of, you know, you have a different problem to solve than has been around previously. And then, of course, there is the inward telepresence where, in order to solve that, you have to create some kind of array of sensors that are probably fixed to a room. And again, ready to hand my wallet to anybody who's ready to sell me a boxed kit where I could just set that up. I'd love that, to have that. Okay, so I'm going to take a little detour to talk about human-computer interaction and how all of that has changed as of 2016. So everybody knows, everybody in here anyway, knows about humans and computers and the interaction between them, human-computer interaction. There's an organization called CHI, C-H-I, Computer-Human Interfaces. It's been around for decades. I don't want to say it's a solved problem, but it's definitely a mature space. And this is, you know, very well explored. But as of 2016, we added another cell or whatever to this Venn diagram, which is the environment. And by adding that one cell, instead of having one overlap region, now there are four. So I want to talk about those overlap regions. One of them, the overlap region between humans and the environment, is conventional reality, which prior to 2016 we like to live in. And now there's this additional overlap region between computers and the environment that I'm just going to call environment understanding. By the way, that's the name of the group that I work in. So just for context. And then I'll say that overlap region where all three of them combine, I'll just call that AR. Another way to look at this is, let's say that we have this sort of taxonomy of real and virtual on one axis and characters and environment on the other. So prior to 2016, we had this situation where there were real characters, virtual environments. And now we have an additional node in this graph, which is the real environment. So this is now part of the interaction scheme. And again, noting that if I just add that one node, the number of edges, the number of possibilities, the number of combinations has doubled. So we went from 3 to 6. Again, this one, the interaction between real characters and the real environment, conventional reality, that's not new. But we have two other modes of interaction here between the real environment and virtual characters and the real environment and virtual environments. And I want to explore what I mean by that. But just remember, this is just kind of a way to sort of frame all of these concepts. So I'm going to show you probably what you'll think of as the least interesting picture you'll see all day, which is a guy holding a teapot. It turns out this is amazing, and I'm going to convince you that it's amazing. And then I'm going to tell you how we did it, or how it's done. So I've already kind of spilled the beans a little. What's interesting about this is two things are going on simultaneously here. One of them is that the teapot handle is occluding this guy's hand, while simultaneously his hand is occluding a different part of the teapot. To achieve this requires, well, we spent a lot of money trying to get this to work. I got it to work, and now I'll sell this, you know, for money in exchange for dollars. So I'll explain how this all works. But it turns out this is actually quite subtle and difficult and sophisticated. So here's another example where this guy is going to stand in front of this hologram and occlude it. Then he'll go behind it. Now the hologram is occluding him. He'll go around another time. And then he will get behind that thing and give it a hug. And he will simultaneously be occluded by and also occlude the same hologram. So that's really cool. Now, what's meta cool about this is that it doesn't look that cool. It just seems like it's supposed to be that way. Of course, it like occludes mutually. If it didn't, it wouldn't look cool. I mean, it would just be broken. It would be nonsense. Sure. So I'll eventually get around to telling you how all this works. So here's another example. So I just talked about a two-way visual interaction. What about a two-way physical interaction? Well, I'll go one way first and then the other way second. What I mean by that is I'm going to show you a video in a second of a bunch of virtual balls bouncing around a real environment that is static. So here we go. The scene is, so if you look at the lower left picture, you see a bunch of yellow virtual balls bouncing around this real environment. And then these other two things show basically the virtual representation of that scene. And it's already kind of giving you some insight into how this works, which is that according to this lower right quadrant, the virtual and the real are both represented in the same way, in some uniform way. And that's really the key to getting all this to work, is that in order to make things look like they're real, we have to make all of it virtual. So we have to take the real stuff and make it virtual, and the virtual stuff start out virtual to begin with. And so we get everything to play nice in the virtual space, and then the sort of the symmetric component of this is now we have to have a display technology that makes the virtual stuff look like it belongs in the real world. So we have to be able to go in both directions. And that is what we call environment understanding, or at least actually it's the early seeds of what I'll call environment understanding. By the end of this lecture, whatever you want to call this, I'm going to tell you how we've done all this, which I think is, again, probably way less interesting than where it's headed. So if you leave before I finish, find out from somebody else what the punchline was, because it's not what you're thinking. Okay, so that was virtual objects moving around in a static environment. The sort of converse of that would be moving real things, manipulating moving virtual things. So here's an example of that. Here are a bunch of little toys that are, you know, the little colored, like, tiny beach balls. And those things are actually virtual, and they're being manipulated by some real person's real hands. I'm going to replay the video. So again, those are fake. Those are not real things. I mean, it's probably obvious, but the point is that he's actually manipulating those things. So the interactions that I talked about. You know, first I showed you this weird abstract Venn diagram and then a graph, and now I'm bringing it back to what are the concrete things that those things refer to? And they refer to, at the very least, bidirectional occlusion. So real occludes virtual, virtual occludes real. And then bidirectional physical interactions. By bidirectional, I mean here we've got virtual things that are moving, interacting with stationary real things, and then here's the sort of converse of that, which, just for the sake of giving it a different name, I'm calling that manipulation. Fine. So now I want to talk to you about the nature of reality, and then I will tell you how our technology works. So we use these terms, augmented reality and virtual reality, and even as the title of this talk has done, we tend to conflate them as being just a minor tweak. I mean, there's only one letter difference between AR and VR. And the implication is that they're basically the same. There's really only a minor difference between them. But I want to convey that in both a philosophical sense, which maybe most people don't care about, but I do, because I'm just nerdy like that, I guess. But in a way that actually changes the way that we think about how to develop experiences, I think that it really makes a difference. So the point is that the difference isn't just that augmented and virtual are not the same as each other. It's that the word reality in those two phrases is not referring to the same reality. They are two different realities, and we should remember that they came from different places, and they're going to take us to different places when we go to one versus another. In the case of virtual reality, we take big R reality, conventional reality, and we completely replace it with something artificial. Even if that world is completely empty, you have completely replaced the real world with a completely empty version of another world. Okay. So the point is 100% of the content in virtual reality is synthetic. That has both pros and cons, because by content, I mean not just the models and the textures and that sort of thing, but also the behaviors. Which means in virtual reality, you can break physical laws. You can even break mathematical laws in a sense. So you can completely, in fact, not only can, you are obliged, you have no choice but to completely replace all the content and all the behaviors in virtual reality with something that you constructed, whether you wanted to or not. That's going to happen. And if you don't do anything, it'll just be a very boring world, but it'll be completely yours. In contrast to that, augmented reality is big R, conventional reality, plus some augmentations. So you don't have the same freedom, but you also don't have the same obligation to create all the content. If you do nothing in augmented reality, you just have the real world. And any little thing you do that adds to that is just a pure addition to that, right? There's no way you can take away from it. But you can't change it. You can't change the physical laws of conventional reality, and you can't currently erase things from it. So that's, again, both a benefit and a drawback, in that if you're going to build an experience that works in augmented reality, You not only get to use all of the content that's here, like this lectern or the couch, you know, the floor and the walls and so on, you're obliged to. You have no choice but to do that, which is actually a very difficult thing to do. If you want to have a virtual character that doesn't walk through this thing, that virtual character somehow has to know about this thing. And that's true of every this thing, you know, I can refer to. And that set of this things is big R reality. So again, this is maybe, you know, it seems like a philosophical difference, but it actually changes the way that you will write experiences for VR and AR. On the one hand, you have to create everything from scratch, and the other one, you have to use things that are already there. So they're in some sense mutually exclusive. So I'm gonna come back to that after the next section. So I just told you have to cope with big R reality and creating these experiences. Now I'm gonna tell you how to do that. So I started out by talking about world-locking holograms. And I didn't say yet how to do it, so now I'm gonna tell you how to do it. And the fundamental technology behind that is a concept called tracking and mapping. So I'm gonna tell you how it works. So what I'm going to draw on this screen is, I'll call it a pose graph. And first I'm going to tell you what the elements of that graph are. So like any other graph in computer science, graphs consist of nodes and edges. So here's a node, and that node represents two things simultaneously. They're really flip sides of the same coin. One side is that it is a picture of the world. So I just take a camera and I take a picture. That's one meaning of this node. The other meaning of that same node is that it is a coordinate frame, which is essentially tantamount to saying, when I took that picture, I had a camera, and that camera had, you know, sort of imaginary axes sticking out of it. You could have the forward direction, the right direction, and the up direction. I mean, you could pick other directions, but the point is that there's a set of coordinate axes that are associated with that camera. So when I draw a node like this, I'm always referring to both of those things simultaneously. So now let's say I take a picture of the world, snap, and then I move somewhere, and I take another picture of the world. Now I can potentially connect those two pictures together. And if I do connect them, I'll draw an edge in the graph like that, and now that edge has a specific meaning. What is that meaning? Just like the nodes, it has two meanings that are sort of flip sides of each other. One of the meanings is that there is some correspondence between those two pictures. And by correspondence, I mean that there's something visual in common between them, something that I can match. So if I have this picture and this picture, there's an overlap region between those two pictures. That's what I mean by a correspondence. The second meaning is that through those correspondences, I'm somehow, hand wave, able to find a transform, a mathematical transform between those two pictures. What I mean by transform is that in order to represent one scene in terms of the other, I can apply a transform, and the specific manifestation of that will be a matrix that includes rotation and translation. So again, that's the meaning of this graph. And now I'm going to sort of describe a situation where somebody walks into, like, let's say this room, and let's pretend there are a bunch of pictures on the wall, like a gallery. And that person will walk around the room facing the walls the whole time. Not facing the center of the room, but facing away from the center of the room. So they walk in, take a picture, let's say of the light switches over there. And then they move along, they take another picture, and that other picture also has some overlap with the first one. And so we're able to figure out where one camera is relative to the other. Now, I'm not going to tell you the computer vision math behind that. Take my word for it, there are equations to solve. You solve them, you get this. He goes a little bit further, takes a third picture. That third picture has overlaps with both of the first two. What's interesting now is that you can solve that same set of equations either between pictures 1 and 2, or between 2 and 3, or between 1 and 3. If you have perfect pictures, all of those will agree with each other perfectly. If your camera is not perfectly noise-free, if it has some distortion that you're not accounting for, and so on, then these links won't be perfectly consistent with each other. And what will happen is, depending on how you traverse this graph, you'll get slightly different answers about where something is relative to someplace else. So if we keep doing this, we'll have this path that gets built up. So what? What's the point? Well, let's say that when we first entered the room, I took a picture of that light switch, and I decided I want to put some sort of augmentation on that light switch. When I got to this place in the graph, I wanted to keep seeing that same augmentation, and because I have this transform, I know how to do that. I have a three-dimensional representation of that augmentation, and now I have a transform that tells me how to go from one 3D space to another 3D space. I keep going along, and if I want to stand here, like let's say the opposite corner of the room, and then look at that light switch, in order to figure out where that augmentation was relative to this anchor, which is where it started, I have to traverse this graph in order to concatenate all of those transforms to get to that original light switch. The larger this graph gets, the more hops there are, and if there's any error in those hops, the worse that alignment is of the hologram to the light switch. There are lots and lots of other subtleties here, but one of the things that I wanted to convey, though, is So how many people here have built a 3D experience using Unity or any other game engine or built your own game engine? So more than half of you. You know how you're used to there being a coordinate frame, like the world? That doesn't exist anymore. You have to deal now with a collection of coordinate frames, and those coordinate frames are connected to each other, but in this kind of transitive way that is no longer direct. And even if you pretend like there is a direct connection between here and here, which you can totally pretend that because you can just concatenate these transforms, the fact is that as we keep building this graph by taking more and more pictures, there are more and more connections that get formed and we get more information. The way that you can think of it is that these transforms are in a way kind of springy and they'll change over time and as more information is collected. So what is the take home? One of them is conceptual, which is that if you start building apps for HoloLens and any other kind of platform that eventually comes out that lets you leave a room, you're gonna deal with this problem. And the first question you're gonna have is, why are they overcomplicating this? I just wanna know where the world origin is. And the answer is, there is no such thing. There is no such thing as the center of the universe, except for, of course, Fremont. If you don't get that joke, go to Fremont. You gotta go to Fremont. There's a sign that literally says center of the universe. But aside from that, there is no such thing, and this is really just reflecting the nature of reality. It is not something we decided to do, it's just the way things are. And now you're gonna be forced to deal with that. So that's one of the reasons why I'm telling you this. The other reason why I'm telling you about it is to understand why things like holograms will occasionally move around, to understand, you know, sort of the nature of those bugs. And there are other reasons, like for example, one of the things that you should encourage users to do is basically scan the room before you start laying out the scene. Okay, so there's a few take homes. Now, I'm gonna talk a little bit more about tracking because I think it's interesting and I think you'll find it interesting too. Remember I was talking about correspondences and I just said there's overlap in regions. Well, in one form of tracking, what you really are looking for are little tiny patches that you're tracking. And one way that we talk about that is called feature detection and feature description. There are lots and lots and lots of feature detectors out there. I just wanted to mention in passing that that's what we're actually looking for, or are these little tiny pictures. So that everything I just said is about visual tracking. There's another kind of tracking, which is inertial. So everybody in here has an inertial tracking system on them, I promise you. And that is because every phone, and actually a lot of watches, and every laptop have inertial measurement units inside of them. They are originally meant to do one thing, which is when I look at it, oh, I don't know if this Apple, yeah, okay. Which is if I look at something in sort of portrait mode and then I switch to landscape mode, it knows what the orientation of the phone is. That's the reason why that was put in there. The funny thing is that the same technology that lets you do that also lets you create guided missiles, which is that it can tell basically the acceleration that is happening on this thing. And IMUs also have built into them a gyroscope which lets you know the rate of rotation of something. They also tend to have a magnetometer so you can know true north, or sorry, magnetic north. And there you've probably seen the apps where you look at the sky and you can see like the constellations and whatnot. So that little thing that does all that is really tiny and really cheap, and it's called an inertial measurement unit. And if you just apply the same kind of ballistic equations that you learned in high school, you can take those inputs and add them all up and you can get your position, velocity, and orientation very, very rapidly and very, very cheaply. So it solves essentially the same problem that visual tracking does, but with a different set of problems. And even better, you can combine the two. So I assume you're all familiar with this. This is a diagram of the Kalman filter, but I'll skip it because it's probably obvious. So if you didn't already know how to implement Kalman filters and weren't already familiar with that, I'll just say that it's just, you just take visual poses, inertial poses, you combine them together, and you get, a lot of people will call it a visio-inertial pose. If you're interested to know more about that, I'm going to cut that off there because I just wanted to give you kind of a broad overview about tracking. if you want to know more, I'll tell you more offline, like we can talk about it later. But I want to get to one more big piece of technology and then wrap it up into the kind of big punchline. That other big piece of technology is called surface reconstruction. And I told you earlier that when you're building stuff for AR, you're obliged to cope with or exploit, depending on your perspective, the real world. So here is how you get the real world into the virtual world. It all starts with knowing your position in space, which is everything I just described. You have to know where you are at every given moment. In particular, you have to know where you are relative to the environment and relative to where you were in the past. So tracking tells you both of those things. The other thing you need to know is, given any particular position in space, how far is it from where I'm standing to any of the surfaces in my vicinity? That latter part comes from depth maps. If you walked into this, I believe that as you're walking into here, there's this big not on screen that I don't know if you noticed, but it has a connect on it. Did anyone notice that? Okay, so that connect has a depth sensor in it. And depth sensors are the thing that basically tells you, given a point in space, how close is any given surface to that point in space. So that's what a depth sensor tells you. One example of that is in this thing called the Dacry, which is the Dacry smart helmet. Dacry is the company, and the smart helmet is the product. In HoloLens, there is a depth sensor inside of it, and if you ever look head-on at a HoloLens, you'll actually see some blinking lights. Those are from the depth sensor. And then also Kinect, both V1 and V2 have depth sensors in them. This is the sort of innards of a Kinect V2. And if you took a picture with one of those and looked at it, it would look like this gray image behind me, which is a picture of my living room and my wife. So here's a chair, here's a little love seat, there's my wife. And then there's a bunch of stuff you can't identify. That's because we're just not used to looking at depth images. But this is another rendering of the same scene where instead of rendering the depth image, I'm actually just rendering the 3D scene that was inferred by that depth image plus other depth images. So far, second least interesting thing you've seen all day, right? I took a picture and then I re-rendered that picture and it looks basically the same. Except you can actually now start to make out some detail. Like this thing in the previous image was inscrutable. Well, it was also obscured by the camera, but you can't really tell what that was, but now it's a little bit more obviously a bookshelf. This is just some kind of a wall. This, you can't really tell from this, but at least you can see the sort of structure of it. It's a fireplace and so on, right? You can actually start to see like some clutter in the background. It's just some more furniture and whatnot. And now you can really start to appreciate the beauty of my wife, because in the previous one, it wasn't clear. And here it's like much more obvious, right? Yeah, she's totally right. But even better, what I can do is take a virtual camera and move it around to places that are novel views of this same scene, and I can keep going further and further. And now you can see a perspective of my apartment, my previous apartment, that would actually not be possible to see, right? Because this would require shaving off my upstairs neighbor's apartment and then putting a camera up in space and then looking straight down. But all this is quite possible with the HoloLens. In fact, all I did to get this was walk around my apartment with my HoloLens, if you have a HoloLens, you can, like, it's a web server, you can just connect to it and then download this mesh. So this is super easy to do. So here's an example of a colleague of mine named Sharam Azadi. This is a Kinect V1, and what he's going to do is wave this thing around this room and reconstruct that room on the fly. So I'm going to probably play this video a couple of times. In the upper left corner is a live feed of the depth map from that Kinect. In the lower left corner, it's showing the 3D model that is being reconstructed from that collection of depth maps, and this is just a re-rendering of the same thing. So these two are just the same thing, just slightly different renderings of it. So I'm going to replay it. But what I want you to notice is, first of all, as this thing waves around, you'll notice it looks kind of like the depth map I showed at the beginning of my living room. But what's happening here is this three-dimensional structure gets kind of painted in as he waves it around. You'll notice like this guy shows up. I don't know if you noticed, there's a dude in the chair. So let me replay it. And watch over here, or over here, it doesn't matter. You'll see the scene getting painted in. Right. So this is a three-dimensional structure that is being inferred by a bunch of two and a half dimensional pictures. Right. So that's what Hollins is doing all the time in the background. How does that work? It works by doing something we call volumetric fusion. Again, I'm sure you're all familiar with this image, so I'll just skip it. So let me first explain, though, that there are some concepts here that are very handy. One of them is a concept called a signed distance function. And I'm going to explain what that is. So let's say that you have space and then stuff inside of space. So when I say exterior, what I mean is empty space. And when I say interior, I mean stuff, right? Like this lectern. Let's pretend like this lectern is solid. And that could be this thing, right? Now I'm going to cast a ray through this. A virtual ray, it doesn't have to be an actual light ray or anything. And then I'm going to explain to you what a sine distance function is as we march along that ray. So anywhere outside of a space, the sine distance function is positive. And anywhere inside of an occupied region, the sine distance function is negative. And right at the interface, which is a surface, the sine distance function is zero. So in other words, ignore the word signed for a moment. The distance function is saying for every point in space, I'm going to go the closest distance to the nearest surface, and I'm going to take that point and I'm going to label it with a number, and that number is that distance. So let's say that we're talking about this in meters, and we'll pretend like this is exactly 1 meter. So this point right here has a distance function of 1. And as I get closer and closer, that number gets smaller and smaller. So this point right here has a value of, let's say, 0.1. Let's pretend like it's 10 centimeters. And then right at the surface, it's zero. And then if I put that probe inside of this lectern, it starts to become negative. And the more I go towards the center of this lectern, it'll keep growing and growing. And then there are certain points where, like right here, if I asked you what the closest distance was, you'd actually have two choices. You could either go here or here, and they're the same distance, okay? That's not necessarily all that interesting, it's just a fact. What's funny about this is, let's say that we populated all of space with this number. Okay, now, like you can imagine looking around this room, and let's say that the closer you are to a surface, the more opaque. Let's say that this is a fog, and the closer you are to the surface, the more opaque it is, and the farther away it is, the less opaque it is. So if you imagine what that would look like in this room, it would be like, if you stood up sort of in the middle of the room, you could see farther and, you know, you'd have like less dense fog. And then if you got really close to like a surface, that fog would be really dense and you wouldn't be able to see very far. Okay. So I'm gonna show how we fill a space with that information and then explain that we actually don't care about the vast majority of that information. It's just a stepping stone to get to where we really want. So let me show you sort of a schematic of how this would happen. So this is, let's say that we took a space and we divide it up into chunks, like a grid, okay? Because we can't literally assign a value to every point in space in a computer because a computer has a finite amount of memory. So we have to discretize or make discrete the space. And so we do that by overlaying a grid. And what I want to do is take a bunch of pictures with depth maps and fill in that grid. So the first depth map is here. That's the sort of region that it covers. And let's say that this is the image that comes back with. There's some object in here. And the black region is the surface of that object. And what I would like to do is fill in this with positive values, this with negative values, and this with zero. The green line shows all the places where it's zero. And I'll come back to the green line later. But I'm going to keep doing that. I'm going to keep moving this depth camera around and just kind of filling in this space. And the way that I know how to do that is, remember, this depth camera tells you the distance to a surface. So if you march a ray from that point through this volume, you know the distance to the surface because that's exactly what the depth map tells you. And so if you march along that ray for every cube that you hit on the way, you can just say, well, I know where the surface is and I know how far away I am from that, so I'm just going to mark that cube with that number. Got it? So then we just keep doing that over and over, and then we end up filling up this space. Every single cube in here will have a number associated with it, which is the distance to the surface. So now you have this volume of SDFs, and all we really care about is where that thing is zero. All we care about are where the green lines are. So we have to take this collection of voxels or volume elements and find out all the places where it's zero. And the way that you do that, or the way that you can do it, is using something called mesh extraction, one algorithm which is called marching cubes, and I'll tell you how it works. So you have all these points in space, any adjacent set of eight of them forms a box. And if the box is regular, you know, it's a cube. Just looking at two adjacent corners of that box, the only time that you really care about what's going on is if one side is positive and the other side is negative. Because that means that somewhere in between those two points, the value of the sine distance function has turned to zero. So you have all these points in space. Every single point has a value. The only places where you are interested are where that value changes from negative to positive, which means the vast majority of the stuff in here doesn't qualify. So what we really want to do is find all those places. So you look for where the sign changes, you do a simple interpolation to figure out exactly where the zero crossing is, and you put a vertex there. You do that for every single edge pair. So here's a pair of pairs of edges, or sorry, pair of points. So there's this edge and there's this edge. We found the zero crossings for both of those. Now that we found two adjacent zero crossings, we're just going to draw a line between them, and that is an edge. You do that for every cube, and if you sort of think through it, you'll find that there are 16 possible combinations of this situation. You will end up drawing some number of triangles, either 0, 1, 2, or I think the maximum is 4 triangles. And now that you have a collection of triangles, you have something that a GPU can digest, and you're done. So that is how you go from having poses, depth maps, and turning that into a bunch of triangles. So now you have a virtual representation of the real world. As an aside, when you do that, you're going to get so many triangles, you will freak your GPU out. And so you generally have to simplify that model, and you have to be careful about how to do that. I'm not going to say more about that because it's self-evident. I want to get to kind of the punchline. I just wanted to mention in passing that even if you ever look at the model in a HoloLens, for example, the ones that I showed earlier, what you're actually seeing is this kind of simplified version because we want not to freak out the GPU. And by freak out, I mean generally overheat. So you can actually get a much, much, much better mesh than the GPU can actually tolerate. And so you end up doing all the simplification. Okay, so just to recap, I talked about these. I started this sort of section of the talk by talking about human-computer interaction, the addition of the environment to that paradigm, and saying that there are interactions that are new or overlap regions that are new in that sort of Venn diagram. And I described occlusion, both virtual occluding real and real occluding virtual. I'm realizing now I didn't actually tell you how that works, so let me rewind for a second. How do you get real things to occlude virtual things? Well, now that you have that polygon mesh, all you have to do is render that mesh as black, and then you're done. Because any time you render something that's black, it's see-through, or in other words, it just kind of masks out. It doesn't show up, right? Because remember what I was telling you about additive displays? Rendering black is the same as rendering nothing. But if you have a hologram that's over here, and I move it back to over here, and you have a surface representation of this lectern, and you render it, well, that rendering will just occlude the hologram that's back here. Why render it black? Well, because you actually want to see the lectern. So if you render the lectern in any other color, you're just going to create a virtual object that occludes the lectern. So that's how you make occlusion happen. How do you make virtual things occlude real things. Well, that's even simpler. You just render them. And the additional light will just confuse your eye into thinking that there's nothing behind it. It's that simple. Okay, so now that you have this virtual representation of the real world, you can pull all three of these things off. And that's it, you're done. So I have now told you everything about the state of the art in environment understanding and how we world lock holograms and how you take the real world and put it into a virtual space and so on. But we use the term environment understanding to explain that, and I would say that that's a far cry from understanding the environment. What we really want to do is actually have computers understand our environment and understand us. So we have a sister team that is called human understanding. And between the two of us, we have this goal, which is understanding things and also to be understood. We want computers to understand us so that they can help us achieve more. One way that I like to think about this is to have a virtual companion. Now, we actually, you know, have something like that. You know, we call her Cortana. And there's, you know, a lot to be said about building companions and building agents that can help us. And I think that that's really the next step. And the stuff that we have right now is as follows. We have these sensors. I think that having these virtual companions is great, but there's a step even beyond that. Neural interfaces. So imagine that you have a virtual companion, but instead of walking along with you or existing in some sort of imaginary space, like a disembodied voice, imagine that that's a voice inside of your own mind. Not coming through your ears, but just part of your consciousness. And take it one step further. Imagine now that that companion is talking to you in your own voice. So now that companion is part of your inner monologue. But that companion has access to the internet. And they have access to these sensors, including maybe ones that are behind your head, or things that can see inside of a spectrum that you can't see inside of, or that can focus hearing in a way that you can't focus hearing. So imagine all the things that you can do. Imagine that you could understand the way that people are feeling, even if they're sitting farther away than, if they're sitting in a place where you're not paying attention to, or because you're not in the mood to pay attention to other people, or because you don't have the ability to. Some people don't have the ability to really understand body language and facial expressions. So these companions cannot just help us achieve more, they can actually help us become better people. And they can help us understand each other better. So there's this virtuous cycle of us getting computers to understand the world, us getting computers to understand us, so that we can all understand each other better.